of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Join with me in the prayer of the day. Lord Christ, by your merciful protection, save us from the threatening dangers of our sins, and divide our wrong with the day of our salvation, for you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us sing our scripture acclamation.
With us for a month. She was so excited to go. I, on the other hand, was a little apprehensive. Allie had never been away from home for more than 2 days. We're going for 28. And the drive would be 16 hours. We would stop in Omaha overnight, but still, it would be 6 hours to our night stop, and then another long 10 hours to our destination. But to my surprise, on the way out, she was totally excited and very engaged. Much to my relief, she barely touched her electronics, and instead she was focused out the window, enjoying the changes of scenery as we went from lush Minnesota green, through Iowa cornfields, through Nebraska cattle country, and into the desert-like scenery of eastern Colorado. We talked and talked about what she was seeing, including the excitement for the very first time in her life of glimpsing the mountains coming closer and closer as we climbed an altitude until we could see the snowy tops sparkling in the sunshine. But it was on the way back home that the car ride lost its appeal. She had now seen it all, and it was beginning to look pretty repetitious, so she turned to her iPad. But when we were about halfway across Nebraska, on the first leg of this long trip home, I heard a small voice behind me say, "Nana, I just don't think I can go any further." She wasn't whining, and up to this point, she hadn't really said much at all. It was just a matter of fact, plaintive lament, "I just don't think I can go any further." And my heart went out to her. From then on, we talked about life, the highs and lows of our trip, and the plans for when we got home. And we grew in our enjoyment of simply being together. But it took a lot more intentionality to get through those long hours. The real truth is that, in a sense, Allie had gone from being a tourist to being a pilgrim. Tourists go from one excitement to another, filling their minds and hearts with new adventures. There is never a dull moment. But as the novelty disappears, so does the desire to go on. And they will choose either a different path or to stop altogether. Pilgrims, on the other hand, are defined as people who are on a journey, often a long and difficult one, most often towards a spiritual goal. Even today, many religions of the world encourage pilgrimages to Mecca, to Jerusalem, to Rome, to the Ganges River, and other deeply religious places. In Jesus' day, 3 times a year, the Jewish people would travel from wherever they lived to Jerusalem for their special holy days in the temple. Just for your information, I looked it up, and the walk Jesus and his parents took from Nazareth to the temple in Jerusalem 3 times a year was 64 miles one way. So this is where we begin with our Psalms today. The Psalms that were read today are part of the Psalms of Ascent. There are 15 of those, starting with Psalm 120 and ending with Psalm 134. It is thought by many biblical historians that these Psalms were actually sung by the people as they pilgrimaged together to the temple in Jerusalem. Eugene Peterson, author of The Message, a paraphrase of the Bible, wrote a very compelling book entitled A Long Obedience in the Same Direction, a Bible study of the Psalms of Ascent. The pilgrim walk is not that of a tourist based on high experiences, but it's an obedient walk towards something deeper and more life-changing. Much of what I'm sharing with you today comes from his book. The first psalm to be sung on the journey was Psalm 120, which is a prayer of repentance. A person today has to be extremely frustrated with the way things are in this world to find the motivation to set up on the Christian way. As long as we think the next election might establish more justice, or another scientific breakthrough might save the environment or more lives, or another pay raise might take away our nagging anxiety, we are not likely to risk the arduous uncertainties of a life of faith. A person has to get fed up with the ways of the world before he or she acquires a hunger for the world of grace. Psalm 120 is a song of such a person, sick with the lies and crippled with the hate. The psalm opens up with, "I'm in trouble." The first step away from the lies of the world is repentance. This is a prayer of repentance. Repentance is not an emotion. Repentance is not feeling sorry for your sins. I'm going to say that again. Repentance is not feeling sorry for your sins. It's a decision and an action. It's deciding that you have been wrong in supposing that you could manage your own life and be your own God. Repentance is a decision to turn and change your ways. In this case, to follow Jesus Christ and become this pilgrim on the path of peace. As the Jewish people started their journey towards Jerusalem, they proclaimed that they are leaving behind the lies and turning to follow God. At the moment we say no to the world and yes to God, all our problems are solved, all our questions are answered, and all our troubles are over. Not so. So we come to the second psalm of ascent, Psalm 121. Since Pastor Dave talked about that one a couple weeks ago and suggested we memorize it, I didn't think it was necessary to reread it again. You do have it memorized, yes? Just for help, remember it begins with, "I lift up mine eyes into the hills. Where does my help come from?" Jerusalem is on one of the highest points in all of Israel. So no matter where you would be coming from, it's an uphill climb. So the people trudged along with their eyes towards the hills ahead. They could be inspired by the ridge and mountains silhouetted against the sky. But the people knew better. They've been on this pilgrimage before. The path is rough with loose stones and boulders. They could easily slip. The forests around are filled with thieves, ready to take their money and provisions, which they carry along for this one trip. Beautiful as they are, help does not come from the mountains. Psalm 121 reminds us that our help comes from the Lord. One of the biggest mistakes we make in Christian discipleship is that we know that God created the universe and has accomplished our eternal salvation. But we can't believe that He chooses us to walk with us through our daily trials and tribulations. To ask God to help us deal with what troubles us each day, we believe is like asking a famous surgeon to put iodine on a scratch. But 8 times in this psalm, the Hebrew word Yahweh God means the one who guards and protects. As Dr. Peterson put it in his book, all the water in the oceans cannot sink a ship unless it gets inside. Nor can all the trouble in the world harm us unless it gets within us. But Psalm 121 says, the same faith that works in big works is the same one that works in little things. In going to God, us Christians travel the same ground everyone else walks on. The difference is that each step we walk, each breath we take, we know we are accompanied by God. The Lord will guard our path, hard as it might be. Which then brings us to the third psalm of ascent, 122. the psalm of worship. Psalm 120 is a psalm of repentance that sets our hearts and minds to turn from the lies of this world and to follow God no matter what the cost. Psalm 121 is a psalm of trust. No matter what the trials and tribulations that befall us, we will trust God to work out his will and guard us from every evil. And if we truly believe that, then our natural response will be that of worship. Psalm 122 begins, "When they said, 'Let us go to the house of the Lord,' my heart leaped with joy." I think in this day and age, we've become confused with what worship really is. Worship is not something we just do for ourselves. Worship is what we do with and for God. Too often, I've heard the excuse from a person for not going to church. "It just doesn't meet my needs. Being in church does nothing for me." That's the tourist mentality. Today, we too often look for what makes us feel good, what gives us instant gratification. We live in what one writer has called the age of sensation. We think that if we don't feel something, there can be no authenticity in doing it. So many fall into the tourist trap of going when we feel like it and ignoring it when we don't. As true Christians, when we choose the pilgrim walk over the tourist, we don't necessarily come to worship because we feel like it. We come out of obedience to God. "In all things, give thanks." God made us, redeems us, provides for us. If you really believe that, the natural, honest, healthy, logical response then is to praise God. Worship gives us a workable structure for life. Worship nourishes our need to be in relationship with God, and worship centers our attention on the decisions of God. Worship, even for those of us who are most faithful at it, takes up just a small percentage of a person's life. An hour or so each week, at most. But in that hour, when we take time to meet God and give him thanks in all things, whether we feel it or not, our spirit starts to sense what God knows. Our deepest needs are not in this world, and they do not have quick fixes. But rather, our deepest needs are for peace and security, like the psalmist says. Worship does not satisfy our hunger for God. It whets our appetite. It deepens our need. And that need overflows the hour and permeates the week. Our everyday needs are changed by the act of worship. It is when we come obediently into worship the first day of the week that we find the will and the longing to walk with God the rest of the week. And it's in our everyday pilgrimage with God that we discover not so much the quick and fleeting highs of the tourist, but the deep soul-satisfying gifts he offers. Gifts of shalom, peace, and shalva, security. Our soul can then take the relaxed stance of one who knows that everything is all right because God is over us, with us, and in us, and for us, in Jesus Christ our Lord. So I urge you, and I ask you to keep reminding me as well, that the pilgrim walk with God is a discipline, not a feeling. Most of us today bristle at the word discipline. We want to be much freer than that. But at the same time, we admire those athletes we just saw in the Summer Olympics who discipline themselves every single day. And we applaud the scholar who disciplines himself to keep studying, practicing, experimenting, even when it doesn't seem to come together quickly and efficiently. Think about it. Discipline and disciple come from the same root word. Jesus calls us to be disciples and follow him. And that takes discipline, not feeling. The Psalms of Ascents give us the outline. Repent, trust, and worship. In closing, I'll add a thought from my last sermon. The pilgrim journey is easier if you walk it with others. Allie could finish the journey from Colorado to home because we did it together. Amen. We will sing together the first verse of 618, Guide Me Ever, Great Jehovah.
In your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
And today, Lord, we also hold up to you our dear members of faith that are struggling with illnesses and other afflictions. We pray for healing for Robert, Brad, Anne, and Hal. We also include in our prayers our friends and family members who are also struggling with illnesses. Sherry, Sydney, Gary, Charlotte, Karen, Eleanor, Lance, Brian, and Clark Ann O'Neill. Strengthen their bodies, both physically and spiritually. And we ask for the peace that passes all understanding for the family of Karen Schumacher on her passing. In your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
And as we walk through our week, give us strength for the journey, so we may return again to worshipful.
Amen. One of the most beautiful things in our weekly worship is our ability to come together as one body, united in Christ, to his banquet table. Let us say, start that series together. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. On the night in which he was betrayed, Jesus took ordinary bread that they were eating and broke it and gave thanks, blessing it, and saying, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat in remembrance of me." In like manner, he took the cup, and when he had blessed it and given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my blood, which was shed for you. Take and drink, and remember what it's done." Let us join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The table is ready. It's ready for all of us, all together to come and worship and dine with him. Thank you. We have come to worship. We have come to be filled with His love and His guidance. May you have the rest of your week to live in that power of worship. Let us close our hymn today, close our worship today with the hymn 807, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing.
Heart, oh, take and seal it.